It's funny with you too, because when I hear about the Smashing Pumpkins, and I hear about like another band you did, and there's this like a dysfunction, like you don't get along with the other band members. And
I
do you?
Yeah, I love the band now.
Great. The band is Smashing Pumpkins, but it's new members.
Yeah. So what? I mean, I don't care what you call it. I mean,
you still write all the songs.
Yeah, but we play rock and roll. I mean, that's the thing. That's what I'm saying. I don't care what you call it. People say, why do you still call it Smashing Pumpkins? Because it irritates people.
Right.
And you can understand, you know what I mean? It's the way to just stick it right back in their eye.
But a lot of times when you break up with band members and stuff, you're the one who goes, I don't understand it. I went to one of the guys in the band. I got down on my knees. I begged him to stay. I begged him to tell me what was wrong. Yeah. And he wouldn't tell you. Mm. And it's almost like, well, are you the problem because of all the dysfunction in your life when you were young?
Or? I certainly contributed to the problem, but I would akin it to a bad relationship. Like, if you get in, let's say you start dating a stripper, right? And
right.
Then the stripper acts like a stripper. Well, you shouldn't have been in the relationship with the stripper. I put up with stuff early on,
right?
Which then, when all the money and all the pressure came in, then all that stuff manifested. I mean, Jimmy Chamberlain, who's one of the best drummers in the world still to this day, I mean, he was an addict when he joined the band,
right?
I mean, we're talking years before our first album. He would disappear for weeks at a time.
Why did you put up with that?
Because he was an incredible drummer.
And so you say, hey, this guy's so good, I'm gonna put up with this guy.
Well, and you don't think, like, you know, fast forward 5 years, we're gonna be playing Madison Square Garden and he's gonna be disappearing. You know what I mean?
Right.
You can't project that far into the future. You know, at that point, it's just like, can we just make the club gig for 100 people? You know, so all that stuff gets weird later, only because then it gets all this other stuff.
But isn't it weird too, because here you are, you're a gem to these other musicians in the sense that you can write music and you can sing like an angel. Yeah, right, but that I'm saying, you wait for a front man like you their entire lives. You'd think they'd put up with any of your horse shit or any of your problems because you're the golden goose.
I think it's different when you grow up together. I mean, we didn't grow up together, but we grew up in the band together.
Yeah.
When you grow up together, everybody thinks they're the same. And I remember,
but they're not. You know, they're not. You're the guy who goes into a room.
But I'll give you. Sorry to interrupt you. But let me give you an example. We would do an interview circa '93, Siamese Dreams blowing up.
Right.
Do the interview. All the interviewer would do was talk to me.
Right.
Because they were obsessed with the album. They want to go, who wrote this album? You know, who wrote these lyrics? Whatever. And we'd finish the interview, and the band would be mad at me.
Right.
Because this guy's asking me all the questions, and I'd say, write your own fucking song. I don't know what I don't know what to tell you.
Right.
You know what I mean? If they're focusing on me. But then when we get behind closed doors, I wasn't like the superior guy. I was just a member of the band. So they started singling me out from the inside and started messing with me on the inside of the band. And then out on the outside, then you got this separating perception. And then you're just caught in the middle. Then it becomes like the Titanic. You just start figuring out what you got to throw overboard to keep the thing up.
Well, as an interviewer, I know when a whole band is sitting there and you have one guy in there who's the singer-songwriter, that's the guy you want to talk to, not the drummer. I mean, it's just the way of the world. And I'm not saying the drummer doesn't contribute, but...
Well, see, like, to Jimmy's credit, he didn't give a shit about any of that.
Right.
He didn't care. He knew he was Jimmy Chamberlain.
He was
always the best drummer on whatever bill we were on. He didn't care. It was the insecurity of the other two that manifested itself in things like arguing about the deli tray. That's why when bands like watch Spinal Tap, we laugh, because that's the kind of shit that happens. Somebody freaks out about the deli tray, you know?
I always think it's so interesting, the dynamics of these bands, because like Bon Jovi was here, and those guys accepted that Bon Jovi was the guy who wrote the songs. He's the leader. He's the guy who does all the business. He does it all. And the other guys are thrilled. They're happy. You just got kind of stuck with people who really couldn't accept that you were the major talent in the band. It's an ego thing.
I swear, cross my heart, and I swear on my mother, I used to say to the band in the mid-90s, when it was super dysfunctional,
right,
I would say, if we don't last 25 years, we're fucking idiots. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity.
Right.
Let's sort out whatever we got to sort out, because once the public identifies with the group, just like I identified with The Who or The Doors, that's their perception, and I thought, well, we can make it work. We're making it work. But they weren't satisfied with that. I mean, James Iha would go and negotiate his own record deal without my knowledge, here's an example. 95, the band's flying high, Melancholy's massive album. He goes and negotiates his own solo deal, right? I don't even know what he's doing. Then I hear he's doing a solo record. Okay, I'd encourage him for years. Do your own solo record. Feel good about your own music. He never consulted me. He never asked even for my advice, like, as a friend. Like,
wow.
Hey, what do you think of these songs? as soon as I heard the album, I had about 40 comments for him that I thought would have improved his album, because right. I would have been the friend that would have said, you could write a better lyric there. Here's a little better. I probably would even shadow wrote some of the stuff for him
right.
behind this and never would have said a word, because I would want him, even just for the business, to make a good album.
Right. It's generous of you to think like that.
But that's how I felt. And then, you know.
But they got jealous of you because you are.
Call it what you want. I used to say to James, you know, I know I stand, you know, 7 feet to your right. My job's a lot harder than you think it is.
Right. You know? Well, you've got to you walk out of a room with essentially an album in your head.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to come out of that room and provide material for the band. You would think in any logical sense that James would have said to you, my God, thank you for these gifts of these songs.
not them. But I think I'll say the positive thing. Because they didn't give a shit about me that way, that's kind of why the band worked in a different way.
But you're
they
right.
They were their own people, you know?
You're 100% right. When you work up a band and a brand name like the Smashing Pumpkins, you sit there. If a guy's going to go do a solo album and he's in your band, it is going to affect the band Smashing Pumpkins. It's going to affect you guys. And they've got to think about that. The band is the thing that comes first.
No, they built up in their minds that, particularly James Darcy, James built up in his mind that he was being a repressed talent.
Right.
Nobody agreed with that. The producers, nobody. I used to be his friend, so I'm thinking I got to help my friend make the best music possible, and it's good for the band, right? Darcy, all of a sudden, circa 97, 98, decides she wants to be an actress. And I remember the conversation where she said, I want to be an actress. And I said, okay. I said, have you ever acted before? No. Have you ever acted in a high school play? No. But I know these people in Hollywood, and this guy's a casting, and he's going to start putting me in movies. And I was like, honey, it don't work like that.
It doesn't.
You'll end up like, you know, the bit part in the Showtime movie, you know? You're not going to be an actress. Like, there's people, that's all they do.
But isn't it insane? Every actress wants to be in a band. It's like everybody wants what they don't have. The thing that they're accomplished at, you know, for years I got offers to do all kinds of talk shows and this
right.
and that. And I always said, I'm good at radio.
Yeah.
This I know. Radio's my thing.
That's true.
And you got to know what you're good at. And it's maddening.
But I've been through my own trips where I thought, oh, I got to be this and that. And at the end of the day, music's been the thing that's made it shake down. We all got to figure this out. To me, they figured it out way too late.
They did. Have they ever come back to you now and said, I made a big mistake?
No. That's what I'm saying. They're the type of personalities that will never do that.
Do they have enough money that they can just kind of say, fuck you, and run off?
No.
They don't?
No.
So what do they do? What are they now doing? Do you have any idea? When's the last time you saw any of them?
Last time I saw James Iha was about a week after 9/11 here in New York.
By coincidence?
It was a coincidence. We just happened to be at the same place. I saw him kind of in the corner of my eye. He was talking to somebody. And the band had only been broken up about 6 months, so there was no particular animosity at that point.
Right.
I saw him out of the corner of my eye. I saw he was in a conversation, just like you would a friend at a party. I thought, I'll talk to him in a few minutes. 5 minutes later, I turned around and said, somebody, oh, where'd he go? He split. As soon as he saw me, he split. That's
wow.
the kind of guy he was. That's the kind of guy he was. I've said it a few times probably. He left the last Pumpkin show, 4-hour show, 14 years together. He left the last show without saying goodbye to me and Jimmy.
It is
split.
It's like suicide.
Hey, we used to say, you know, cut your nose off to spite your face, you know?
Yeah, and if you want to almost grab these guys, shake them and go, mm-hmm. Do you see what we have? Do you know what the odds are of us becoming a success?
I tried all that. But honestly, from the bottom of my heart, I mean, I'm glad the guy's out of my life now, you know? And now that... Because that was its own form of abusive relationship. And now that the guy's out of my life, believe me, I couldn't be happier. The guy I'm in the band with now, Jeff, incredible guitar player, great friend, totally moral support.
Did you have a point in your life when those guys leave,
mm-hmm.
Do you go, oh my God, I can't go on without them? That now
yeah,
I'm.
It's like a relationship where you psychologically bind. Look, when you're coming into a room and there's the asshole, you know, Irish journalist, and he wants to tear you guys apart. You almost kind of bond together in a gang mentality, even if you're not bound together behind the scenes, right?
Right.
It's just natural instinct. So when you go out in the world alone or with different people, and you don't have that same affinity, you miss that sense of kind of we can band together when we have to.
Yeah.
I mean, we used to do very contentious shows. I'd say all sorts of crazy stuff, and they would stand with me. You know, they'd walk off the stage. So there was a sense of
family
unity, and so. And in my mind, psychologically, I never wanted to be without that family. So it's taken me a long time to let all that go and realize what was good about it, what was bad about it. I don't want it back in any way, shape, or form.
And what's funny, I hear the new album and I think you're as good as ever. So it's like you kind of, it was just a psychological crutch. You didn't really need them to make this album.
No, and I think that's sort of the beauty of this is because I've had to hear for over a decade that something that they did in that room had something to do with what I did that was so successful. Now right. This album comes out and everybody goes, okay, we were wrong about that.
No, it's you. It's clearly you.
But when you're running around the world trying to tell people that because they don't like your weird solo album or something, it's a proof in the pudding type of thing.
No, in fact, this sounds like a Smashing Pumpkins album. I mean, it doesn't sound like it's something foreign or that you're missing a component.
I always knew what I did, you know, and they did contribute. I never want to take away what they did, but it's hard for people to understand how much I actually did.